you can remove 90% of the nano and microplastics in your tap water by boiling it. So, if the solution is this simple, why are microplastics such a problem? Because this water doesn't just contain microplastics, it may contain science. Nano and microplastics are little plastic particles somewhere in the range between 1 nanometer and 5 millimeters. That is to say, they range from the width of a pencil to half the diameter of a strand of DNA. So, if you're thinking of these as grain of sand size, yes, those are included. But it's not just the ones you can see, like microbeads in exfoliating wash. These particles can be a fraction the size of a human cell, with no hope of spotting them with the naked eye or even many microscopes. Some tiny plastics were designed small, like those microbeads in the face wash, but many nano and microplastics were once larger plastics that broke down into these tiny particles. And if you think sand is rough and coarse and gets everywhere, try something a fraction its size. Micro and nanoplastics are in our food, soil, water, air, and very much in our water. Oceans, waterways, lakes, even rain. So, it is no surprise that nano and microplastics have made it into our tap water. What is a very pleasant surprise is that we can get them out of our tap water using pretty easily available at-home methods. A new study published in Environmental Science and Technology Letters showed that boiling water can reduce 90% of the 3 microplastics they tested, big-name plastics like polystyrene, polyethylene, and polypropylene. How does this work? Well, there are 2 things I could mean when I say boiling water. One is distillation, shown here in an absolutely ancient print. This is how a chemist might still approach purifying their tap water for science. On the left, you have the tap water, and you heat it in the flask. When you reach the boiling point of water, it evaporates out of the flask on the left, then the vapor travels upward and ultimately rightward, where we're running some cool water over the second flask to keep the glass cool, thereby condensing the water again. Voila! Liquid water in the right side flask. Anything with a boiling point above that water isn't going to vaporize immediately, and these plastics don't break down at low temperatures like 100 Celsius, so they don't come with the water that moves to the right. Distillation is the most reliable method to remove nano and microplastics, as well as forever chemicals like poly and perfluoroalkyl substances. You can get more than 99% of them right out of your water that way. Only problem is, I'm not a chemist, I don't have these flasks, and that's way more work than I'm gonna put into every flask-size volume of tap water. So then, we get to the other method of boiling water. The method you use when boiling water for noodles. Normal boil water in a pot heats the water, but the method itself isn't aimed at catching the water that vaporizes like distillation does. So in theory, when you boil water, you lose a little bit of water to evaporation, plus whatever has a lower boiling point than water, which again, does not include microplastics. So on the surface, it seems like the plastics would just stay in this water that we've heated somewhat. So, what's going on? Does the boiling facilitate a chemical reaction? Like, are we breaking down the plastic? It turns out this new method works by clumping the microplastics with other stuff. The idea is simple. Our tap water doesn't just have water in it. It has microplastics, for one. But it also has minerals dissolved into it. Things like magnesium, zinc, calcium carbonate, and so on. You may have heard tap water high in mineral content called hard water. And hard water is pretty common in a lot of American households, for instance. Most of the time, that's pretty annoying. You get that whitish mineral buildup in your sinks and so on. But for the purpose of microplastics, it allows for this cool interaction. When we boil the water, the minerals in it will undissolve or precipitate out of solution in the water. It's why you have to descale your tea kettle sometimes. And it turns out, microplastics get caught up in the clumps of calcium carbonate. So, if you boil water and then run it through a coffee or similar filter, you're filtering out the calcium carbonate, but in so doing, you're also filtering all the microplastics in those clumps too. That's why hard water was particularly effective in this study at getting rid of microplastics using this method. There's more calcium carbonate in the water to catch the microplastics. This finding got significant coverage all around the world, and for good reason. Even if we can't get all the microplastics out of our drinking water, reducing them by 90% is a huge reduction in our total drinking plastics load, and that's all to the good, especially since this is a method people can actually practically use at home, one that's accessible at low cost around the world. And indeed, at this point, our scientists ride off into the sunset. It's a happy story in a branch of environmental science that often feels like downer. It's great. I love it. Don't get me wrong. It's just... Well, so how is this stuff in our rain cycle then? Anyway, after all, if you're anything like me, you learned about the water cycle from a diagram something like this. Water evaporates, the vapor rises, condenses into clouds, it rains down, and then it's liquid water on the ground again, ready to evaporate. In effect, the water cycle isn't like boil water for noodles, like the method in this paper. No. The rain cycle is like distillation. Microplastics aren't going to evaporate with the water, just like in distillation. So how are they in our rain? Well, it's in part by its participation in a different cycle, one that is less often taught in middle school earth science. It's called the dust cycle. Think about it. Dust travels on the air. I mean, think back to the last time you cleaned out your supply closet. Dust flies everywhere, right? Big particles, like sand, don't move real far because gravity drags them back down. But the lightest dust particles are easily carried on air currents, transported up to several thousand kilometers by wind and upward into the atmosphere. Up there, dust particles act as seeds for clouds and they come down with rainwater. In fact, in big storms, big enough to create convective vertical updrafts, they'll slurp particles into the storm cloud and then rain them on down. Dust is primarily made out of silt and clay, but for the purpose of being a tiny particle carried on the wind, what's the difference between clay or silt and plastic? In one experiment, researchers used buckets with rainfall sensors placed around parks and protected areas. These collector sensors came in pairs of wet bucket and dry bucket. When the rainfall sensor detected rain, the wet bucket opened up to collect rainfall while the dry bucket closed. By contrast, when it was sunny and dry, wet bucket closed, dry bucket opened, catching dust particles carried on the wind, but not the rain. Across sample stations, both buckets caught microplastics in their dust. The dry bucket had smaller particles, the kind easily carried on the wind. The wet bucket, on the other hand, had bigger microplastic particles, particles that were slurped up and carried by storm systems. So microplastics may be in our water. Yes, absolutely. But the dynamics of microplastic transport around our world are not tied to the water cycle in the way we might think. Instead, they much more closely resemble our dust cycle. None of which is news to scientists. The pair of buckets study is from a few years ago. But it's important for us to know because it affects how we think about environmental microplastics. So often when we think about these chemicals in relation to our water, but it's important to understand how it gets in that water. And that's not the only reason. As we talked about in our PACE story, atmospheric light scattering from aerosols and particulates, like dust, can affect climate, and if microplastics are all up in our dust cycle, they can likewise act on these same climate phenomena. Collectively, all of these studies help us figure out new ways to decontaminate our environment and ourselves with the microplastics we're putting in it. It's really good news that we have reliable, household-level ways of reducing our microplastic consumption that don't rely on this. So often, News about microplastics or forever chemicals seems really depressing. It's happening on an industrial scale, individuals have limited ability to change it, and it can all feel so hopeless that we stop thinking about it because it's too upsetting. Honestly, if I'd thought about microplastics for a minute, of course. They haven't evaporated into our water cycle. The dust cycle makes way more sense. But it hadn't occurred to me, not because I don't know how evaporation works, but honestly because a little piece of my brain turned off with anxiety. And that's an understandable protective mechanism. Everything is happening so much all the time, and in the year of our pork 2024, that cannot be truly overwhelming. But the more we learn about microplastics in the environment, the less it's a ominous dark blob of scary, and the more, hey, these are just particles. We have a lot of them in our environment, and there's a lot of science we can do to better understand them, how they interact chemically and biologically, and how they move around our world. But understanding that big picture is what gives us the context to develop solutions to actually address nano and microplastics. Solutions like, well, what if we boil water about it? It's a real, meaningful solution for individuals, something we can do something about. Even though, now that I think about it, it's more about leaving the solution. Because as the old joke goes, if you're not part of the solution, you're part of the precipitate.